I'm so excited. School is just about to start. Woo-hoo! I can hardly wait. How many of you, I'm getting some really dirty looks up here. How many of you are excited about the new year? Yeah, it's gonna be a great year. I just feel it in my bones. Boys and girls, have you ever come home from school? It's been a hot, hard day. And you walk in the door and you go, Mom, I'm home. And you say, I'm so hungry. And your mom says, there's a snack for you on the table. I sliced up a lemon and put it on a plate. It's in there on a plate on the table. Go ahead and have a snack. Has that ever happened to you?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, Chelsea, you picked my grandbaby lemons for a snack. Has that ever happened to you? What do lemons taste like? They're sour. I can smell these lemons and it just grabs me right in here. They're so sour. Boys and girls, it's not a good snack, is it? Now we cook with them and we put them in our tea and we do different things with them. Have you ever heard the saying, being stuck with a lemon? You got stuck with a lemon. You know what that means? It means that you got something that was worthless or had a lot of problems. We had a car one time that we said was a lemon. We got stuck with a lemon because it broke down all the time. But at the same time, boys and girls, one of my favorite drinks is made with lemons. Lemonade, that's right. My sister-in-law, Linda, she makes the very best lemonade ever. She slices up just the right amount of lemons, puts them in the pitcher, pours water over them, adds just enough sugar, the right amount of sugar, puts them in a pitcher, and lets them sit there for a while. And then when it's ready to drink, she pours it over ice, and it is the best lemonade you will ever drink. So Linda takes something that at first doesn't taste good. She takes something that at first is very sour and adds something very sweet and makes a delicious drink. Have you ever heard the saying, when life gives you lemonade, when life gives you lemons, make lemonade? Sometimes, boys and girls, in life, bad things happen. That's just life. And probably, maybe none of you have experienced that before, when bad things happen to you or your family. But it's going to happen one of these days. Sometimes bad things just happen. Maybe with your group of friends at school, everybody got invited to a party, but you. Or maybe you got real sick right before the big trip to Six Flags and you weren't able to go. Or maybe something even worse happens, like somebody gets sick or someone passes away in your family. But bad things are going to happen, boys and girls. But the good news is, and I want you to hear this, the good news is that if we belong to Jesus, He is always with us 24/7. Even during the hard times, Jesus is right there with us. And He promises that good things can come from bad times. Good things can come when you're going through difficult situations. Just like lemons need something to make them sweeter, we need Jesus to make our lives better. And like adding sugar to lemons, God can use you to make things better for someone else. That may mean, now this is a big one, that may mean that you have to step up and apologize to your brother or sister for the fuss that you had. That may mean you have to step up first and say, look, I'm sorry. You know, I didn't mean that. I'm so sorry. Or it may mean that you need to spend a little more time on your homework to make a better grade. But God can use us. Boys and girls, from the Bible in Romans 8:28, He says, we know that in everything God works for the good of those who love Him. That means that if you love God, He will bless us and help us even in hard times. So when hard times do come to you, or sad times, or worrisome times, whatever's happening in your life, you remember that God can take that and make something good out of it. And He can use you to make things better for somebody else when they're sad or they're down or going through hard times. Let's pray. Father God, we just thank You for this day, Lord, and we thank You that You brought these children to church this morning. Father, I thank You for loving us. I thank You that, thank You for staying close to us, Father. When life throws us a lemon, I just thank You for being with us 24/7. our lives are sweeter when you're with us, Father. We just thank you. We love you so much. In your name we pray. Amen. Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries?
Focus is. You may have to turn the lights off over there, but So there's thorns, cactus, and all that, but there's mountains in the background. So sometimes we get so focused in on the things that are near to us, the thorns, and the struggles, and the issues, that we miss the mountains. So where is your focus? Where is it? I'm sure everyone everywhere at some point has felt defeated. You may have felt this defeat for the right reason. Maybe it was you lost the big game. Maybe you got bumped off. Maybe you missed a loop in the arena when you should have caught, you missed. Or maybe you just hit a barrel in a barrel race. There's all kinds of things that happen that cause us to feel defeated. And all of those, I said, are proper defeat because you have lost. If that happens, more than likely you lost. But that doesn't define you and who you are unless you let it define you. See, there's many things that will bring us down. Many things that will tear us down. Many things that will try to rip us apart. And if we let it, then we are in defeat. Losing is part of life. You're going to lose things. Heck, I lose stuff all the time. The other day I was looking for my phone when I had it in my hand, using my phone to help me look for my phone. We lose stuff. It happens. And sometimes we lose big things. We lose big things. And sometimes we lose little things. Losing is part of it. And being defeated is part of life. But staying hung up in that defeat, staying hung up in that thinking that you're defeated, thinking that you're worthless, thinking that this is the end, this is all it is, and it defines you, is hanging around in that sticker patch rather than looking at those mountains. And that's where our enemy wants us. He wants us hanging down in that. He wants us to feel lost. He wants us to feel defeated. He wants us to feel worthless. He wants people that are speaking at us, telling us this, to stay there. But the problem is we need to quit misplacing our focus on that. Stop looking at what other people are saying. Stop listening to what the wrong things are they're saying to us, what the world is saying. Because right now, if you're a Christian and you're honoring God and you're seeking to glorify Christ in all things, the world hates you. We're one of the most condemned and hated people groups, period. People who are honoring God, faithfully following Him, are hated more than anybody out there. And I will say, we're discriminated against more than anybody. And it doesn't matter what skin color you are. If you're a Christian who's honoring God completely, you are hated in this world right now more than anybody. So we need to stop listening to them. We need to start clinging to the one who can deliver us. We need to cling to the one who can pull us out of whatever it is that we're struggling through. We need to cling to His works and nothing else. Much like, you know, when I still was a cowboy, and I always had a knot latch on my side. You know, that's the strap that goes around your swells, if anybody that may not know. I had that thing on there all the time. It never, but as a matter of fact, it is still on my saddle to this day. And I had a lot of people over the years give me a hard time about it, but I told them my job, my goal is to always stay on, not fall off. And if it takes this to keep me on, that's what I'm going to do. Well, that's the thing. You hold on to that knot latch, and if your horse goes to bucking and all this, that, and other, and all kinds of things going on, you have that. If you hold on to it, more than likely you can stay on. But if you get to looking around and get to gawking off, or sometimes just get shook free, I promise, I used to tell people, if I got this thing, nothing could buck me off. That was a lie. I said that one morning, as soon as I said it, I got drilled. So it happens. But the thing is, that thing is something to help us hold tight and stay. Well, God holds us even better than that. He's the knot latch, and He is the one holding us to the knot latch. He is the one that will keep us there. So we need to cling to Him. Cling to what He has said over anything else in this world. There's going to be tests that come. There's going to be struggles that come. There's going to be issues that hit. There's going to be problems in life. We're going to have fights. We're going to have battles. We're going to struggle. And we may not fully understand all of it, but if we focus on Him, we'll eventually see the reasons. If we focus on Him, we'll make it through. If we focus on Him, we'll be able to survive. But if we're looking at anything else, we're going to fall. So let's look at Psalm 3, where we see where David, King David, who has struggled through so much, and is this title, which are part of the Psalms, which are actually scripture themselves. It says a Psalm of David when he fled from Absalom, his son. Just a little backstory that Absalom had come in to take over the kingdom. His own son was overthrowing him, and he fled from his son who was out to kill him. Fled into the wilderness with about 600 of his own men. That was it. The rest stayed. He fled from this. David was in a major bad situation of his own son, his own flesh and blood, seeking to kill him. I'd say that's probably a worse situation than any of us have ever faced. But this is what he wrote. Oh Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. Many are saying to my soul, there is no salvation for him in God. But you, O Lord, are a shield about me, my glory and the lifter of my head. I cried aloud to the Lord. He answered me from his holy hill, Selah. I lay down and slept. I woke again, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you strike all my enemies on the cheek. You break the teeth of the wicked. Salvation belongs to the Lord, your blessing beyond your people. Yeah. He had many against him. Thousands were against him. A whole nation had turned against him. His own son was against him. Yet he's like, I trust you, God. I trust you. So one of the first observations we see in this is people will turn against you. People will turn against you. David had those enemies. And they were confident that they had victory over him. They were confident that God was against him and for them. They were confident of this, and he was running from them, but he was reaching out to the Lord. He left because he knew he had died. He didn't, but he was not worried about them so much as that. He knew God had him. And if you read that story deeper, you see that he told his commander of his armies not to kill his son. Even though his son was out to kill him. He told him not to. He was trusting God to deliver him through all of this. He trusted in the Lord. And he had all these people against him. He had a world against him. And maybe you can relate to this same thing. Maybe you have many people against you. Maybe you're struggling through many things. Maybe you're fighting battles that you can't figure out. Maybe you're in a horrible situation. But I want you to know, just as David did, you have the Lord. You can rest in the Lord. There's demons against you. There's people against you. The enemy is totally against you, and people will turn. But if you have the Lord, you have comfort. You have peace. And as one guy says, how many enemies does it take to make life miserable? How many do you think it takes? And he goes on and says, one will do if he or she is determined enough. One person against you can make your life miserable. If they try hard enough, they fight hard enough. But the thing is, we focus too much on that. No, we get too focused in on those against us. We get too focused in on what's happening around us instead of looking where we should. We allow the here and now to destroy us rather than looking above. Just like I had that picture of me of all the cactus and all that right there, we focus in on it just like that camera. I had that picture right there on that. Rather than seeing the mountains beyond. We let things like that draw us down. And then people may even tell you that God is against you, that there is no God, that you're on your own, that you're fighting alone. And that is a devastating thing to hear, because to think that there is no help from God is one of the most bitter afflictions to have. But I'm telling you today, there is a God, and that he is for you if you are his. If you are in Christ, God is for you. If you are in Christ, you have him on your side. If you are in Christ, you have the power of Almighty God going before you, beside you, and behind you. You are surrounded. Rest in that. Don't let the people who say, who cares about you? Don't listen to the people who are saying you're worthless. Don't listen to the people who are condemning you. Don't listen to all of that nonsense. Listen to what God has said about you. And God has said you are loved. God has said you are mine. God has said, I will keep you. Nothing will take you from me. I will not forsake you. Rest in that. Because you're not fighting in this alone. You are not alone. God is for you and he is fighting. Just as David says here in verses 1 and 2. The foes are against him, but the salvation is there. He can trust in God because you have a protector too. Just as he had. He is your shield. He is your guard. He is your glory around you. He is the one who holds you. He will lift your head. You're in a crisis. He is the one who breaks the crisis. I don't know what to do about that. It's on. Anyway, I mean, if you have a crisis, you're struggling through things, as David was, we see this here. He's got this horrible crisis, this horrible battle, this horrible situation, all of this bad going on. But he says, you're my shield. You're my glory. See, a shield, we all know what a shield does. A shield will protect you. A shield will guard you. But guess what? A shield can only cover so much, can't it? So you have to do like the Romans did and the Spartans did and create the phalanx with the shields where you're perfectly protected. That's where they interlock their shields and everybody's covered. Well, God surrounds you just like that. He is your guardian. He is your protector. He is your keeper. He is the one who will stop all things from getting to you. And the thing is, it doesn't matter if things get to you, because with God, you have power. We need to trust Him. That's what he says here. He's our glory. He is the one who surrounds us. When his glory is surrounding you, what is going to happen? Darkness flees. When his glory is coming from you, darkness will run. When his glory is shining all over the place, darkness will leave you alone. Because darkness cannot stand in the light. Darkness cannot face the light. As I said before, you flip a light switch on, what happens? As long as the light switch works, darkness is gone immediately. That's his glory coming from you. And the thing is, have we cried to him as we see David talking about here? Sometimes we complain. Sometimes we gripe about stuff to our friends, our family. But if you really just cried out to God for these things to leave you, if you really cried out to God for this relief, if you cried out to him to give you this protection, or maybe you have and you don't think he's listening, maybe you have and you don't think that he hears you. But David dispels that because he says, he has answered from my holy hill. He has answered you. He will hear you. He will deliver you. It just may not be in the form you think. You may have to struggle and fight through, but he will take care of you. Sometimes we have to go through these valleys. Sometimes we have to go through the canyons. Sometimes you have to go down that rough river and get turned over a time or two and crawl back in that raft and keep going to get to the end. Sometimes life is hard. Sometimes it is rough. Sometimes it'll beat you plumb to a pulp. But you keep crying out to God, he'll keep delivering you. He does these things to test us. He does these things to see if we're going to call out to him or if we're going to fall back to these other ways. Trust him. Trust him to deliver you. Trust him to take care of you. Trust him to always lift you up, because sin is always going to beat you down. But God will always lift you up. If you go to sin, the sinful ways to try to get comfort, you're going to be beaten down. If you keep going to sinful ways, thinking that's going to deliver you from the stuff, if you think going in and be like, oh, when in Rome, do as the Romans do, and start following and acting as the way the world is attacking you, all that's going to do is bring you low. God will lift you up. God will give you comfort. God will give you peace. He will give you true peace. As we see in verses 5 through 6, it says, I lay down and slept. Who in here struggles to sleep sometimes because of anxiety? Who in here lays in bed and their brain is rolling 100 miles an hour worrying about things that you can't even fix? That's because we're trusting ourselves to fix it instead of giving that to God and saying, I know all this bad stuff's going on. I know all this struggle is happening. I know this stuff is horrible. I can't do anything about it, though, but you can. I give it to you. I give it to you, Lord. Just like Saving Private Ryan, where the sniper, they're laying in the old bombed-out church after they're going out looking. And the sniper's over there asleep. All the other guys are up talking, smoking, and this, that, and the other. And like, how can he sleep like that? Well, he's got a clear conscience. And they're sitting there, it's like he's always saying something. And they can't quote it. It's a scripture, and they can't quote it. They're trying to figure it out. And the one guy, up on the kind of cowardly guy, quotes it and says, if God be for us, who can be against us? That's what he quotes as he's shooting a lot of times. He knows where his strength comes from. He knows where his protection is so he can sleep. In the middle of a war zone, being shot at left and right, horrible situation, he was able to sleep. And that's the same promise that God gives to us, that we can sleep. Why be afraid of the thousands if you have the all-powerful God on your side? And as Paul says in Philippians 1:21, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. Why fear? If you're in Christ, you're going to be with him forever. It's just a speedier entry to him. So we just got to look at life and go, you know what? I can't fix that. You know, this economy's bonkers. I can't fix that. You know what? All this evil is running rampant out there. These people are acting foolish. All I can do is deliver the message to them and let the Holy Spirit work, but I can't change them. You know what? School system is struggling because of this, that, and the other. There's people infiltrating, trying to cause grief there. There's kids. There's things you can't do that you used to be able to do to correct them. There's all this battle going on. I can't fix that, but you know what I can do? I can be an agent of the Lord at all points. But I can't fix it and stop it so I can sleep at night. You know, all of these battles, all of these things that we try to carry, these burdens that we try to carry that we can't fix, we need to lay down at the foot of the cross and say, Jesus, take these because I can't do it. He's the only one that can fix it. He's the only one that will fix it. We need to quit carrying burdens that we were never meant to carry. And that's what anxiety does. As we fight with this and we carry all this worry and concern and anxiety and struggle of stuff that we can't fix, we're telling God, I don't trust you. I've got to fix this. As hard as that is to swallow, that's basically what we're saying. Is you can't fix this, God. I have to. And that's not what we're supposed to do. Because Psalm 127:2 tells us, he gives to his beloved sleep. Sleep is a precious thing that God gives us. And we need to sleep. We all probably need to sleep more than we let ourselves sleep. I know I lived a long time in my life where all I was doing was about 4 to 5 hours of sleep a night. And I was going and blowing and working and doing all them other hours, and I felt lazy if I slept more than 5 hours. I found out how stupid that is. Because your body will crash. God has designed us to rest. That's why he tells us to rest a lot. You read scripture, you see in there a lot of times where it says, rest in me. Have rest. Rest. Be in peace. We got to stop fighting. Because David slept knowing that the days, the fights, the struggles of the day were still there, and they'd be there tomorrow, that he knew in the Lord he had peace. And we can sleep the same way. And when we do that, then we can live with confidence, as David does here in verses 7 through 8, where we see this, arise, O Lord, save me, O my God. That is a battle cry throughout Scripture. We see this. It is a cry of confidence because he knows God has heard him. He is crying it out, as we see in back in Numbers with Moses and all that. Whenever they were fixing to march out, they were moving forward. In Numbers 10, 33 through 36, we see where Moses would cry out, rise up, O Lord, may your enemies be scattered, may your foes flee before you. And as they come in at the end of the day, it said, return, O Lord, to the countless thousands of Israel. David was crying out the same battle cry. May your enemies be scattered. As he says here, you strike all my enemies on the cheek. You break the teeth of the wicked. That means he has removed their bite. What can they do? Their teeth are gone. This is the power of our God. Give it to him. Say, Lord, strike them. Lord, you do your damage to them. You do this. You take them out. Not me, you. You're powerful. You're mighty. Your judgments are perfect. Your wrath will fall out on these wicked, evil people in a manner that I couldn't even dream up for their bad. But Lord, I pray that they come to you before that happens. Lord, strike them on the cheek. Wake them up. Make them see. But not me, you, Lord. That's what we got to do. And we can live confidently because we have the God who is that powerful. We have that God. We have the one true God on our side. Why do we walk around scared and afraid and beat down when we have that power? It's because we keep trusting in ourselves, not Him. We keep wanting to lean into ourselves, not Him. We keep wanting to go on our power, not His power. We keep thinking we can fix the problem, not Him. We've got to stop doing that and give it to Him. And we can do that. We can do it because He is all-powerful. He is our God. And without the Lord, there is no solution or success. There's none. It's all Him. All Him. 100% Him. Because if we try to fix it, I'm telling you right now, I know exactly what happens. It's like whenever I try to do some work that I'm not any good at, I'll get after it. Oh, yeah, I got this. No problem. And I tear it up worse. And then it cost me about 10 grand more because I tried to fix it instead of calling some man spending $1,000 to get it fixed to begin with. That's what happens when we try to fix the situations in our life instead of giving it to God. It ends up costing a whole lot more than if we had just threw it to Him and said, here, take it. I can't do it. That's what He wants you to do. He wants you to say, Lord, this problem is too big for me. Here, arise, O Lord, take this, smack them on the cheek, shatter their teeth, do whatever you've got to do, but here it is, God, I can't do it. That's what He wants. And that's how you can live confidently. You can walk out in the world facing everything that comes at you and smiling and laughing and going on without a care in the world because you know who's got your back. God is for you if you're His. You can have that confidence. You can have triumph in God. You can find true peace and rest in the world if you rest in the protecting and sustaining power of the Lord. But we've got to keep our focus true. We've got to stay focused on Him. As David did, we see this. He brings his complaints. All these people are against me, but I have you. All of this is against me, but I have you. All of this is going on, but I can rest because of you. All of this is going on, but you will take them out, Lord. He's not saying that we don't need to give our problems to Him. We don't need to talk about them. We need to give them to Him. We need to pray to God and to give it to Him and leave it with Him. Because if we take our focus off of Him, we will miss the target. Much like this Olympic shooter named Matt Emmons back in the 2004 Olympics. He was right there fixing to win his second gold medal. He was in the lead position of the 50-meter, three-position rifle competition. He was far enough ahead that all he had to do was hit the target. Anywhere in the target, he just had to hit it. That was it. And he had a one. Well, he steps up there, and he's got it. He's aimed, just calm, pulls the trigger, another bullseye. He's like, all right. But the scoreboard doesn't light up. It doesn't do anything. And three red-jacketed men approach him. And he's like, oh, they're just coming to tell me the board's broken, but I've got it won. But he was stunned when the officials told him that he'd hit the wrong target. That day, he got a zero and did not win. Because he had hit the wrong target. When we're going through life trying to handle all the problems and all the struggles and all the difficulties that come at us on our own, we're always hitting the wrong target. We get zeros left and right, and we wonder why we're so deflated, so defeated, so worn out every day. It's because we keep trying to make that shot on our own instead of giving it to God. We keep walking through the battlefield without any kind of weapon. We keep going out day in and day out trying to fight the battle on our own. But if we give it to God, if we trust in Him, lay it down at His feet. Say, Christ, I'm yours. Take these problems. I can't do it, but you can. Only way I can make it is by you through me. That I can't solve these problems. I can't worry about them anymore. It is killing me. It is destroying me. It is ripping me apart. They are yours. Please deliver me. I promise, when you start acting that way, living that way every day, you will have more joy, more peace, more comfort, and more strength to face the day than if you try to keep on hitting that target on your own. I promise if you do that, you'll be like that Olympic shooter who was talented and gifted and able, but he hit the wrong target. Stay focused on the Lord. And when you do, you will have that true victory. Because as I've said 1,000 times from up here, we are in victory right now fighting from a place of victory. We're not fighting to it, we're fighting from victory. Let's just keep giving our problems to the one who is victorious. And that's how we'll find true peace, the true rest. Keep your focus there. Stay focused on the Lord. Trust Him to deliver you, and He will do it. If you need to talk or pray or anything about anybody, I would love to pray with you today. I'll be at the back, waiting on you. Chris, we close this prayer again.
Dear Lord, we come to you today, and Lord, we just ask that you get us out of our own way and just allow us to put you in front and in center so we can hit the right targets, that we can bring people closer to you, that we can be a light. Lord, I ask.